Amen.
I don't know about you all, but I'm excited about this cooking going. Not that I just get to smell it, or I even get to help watch Lorna bake them, but the prospects of breaking at least one out of the dozens of cookies we're going to make is great. Just saying. I know. I got a nurse who wants to talk to me after service here. How exciting is it that you can reach out and touch prisoners for Jesus Christ through a ministry that normally we would have no ability to be part of? That's exciting to me. It's exciting to join with other brothers in Christ as they go and minister to those folks, because they need to know about Jesus just like everybody else. God loves those men just as much as He loves you and I. And we have the ability to help participate. I'm in. How about you all? You all in? So that 30 dozen should be easy to make. That's the goal. I expect to go over it, because I want to give a chocolate chip cookie in the name of Jesus. So get to baking and have a lot of fun doing it. All right, today's sermon is, the title of the message is called The Message of the Cross. Now the season has ended. Easter is now over, but everybody's eye and mind is still focused on the cross and the resurrection. I passed the church the other day. I love this sign. It says, the tomb was empty, so our churches should be full. For that very reason. Unfortunately, we didn't reach that goal today. We are looking a little sparse. So pray for everybody that's not here. Some of them are away. I know some of the flu bug and all that's going on. So pray for those folks so they can get back to worshiping with us, because I do miss them all. The world is full of divided lines. We tend to do that as humans. We divide everything into categories. That helps us, A, understand it, and B, we get to sort out and figure out what's best for us. I don't know about you all, but if you're willing to be honest, I put things in categories. I divide things. That way I know which pile. You can see kids, I love to see this, back in my day, they don't give marbles anymore. I don't even think they make marbles anymore, but you can see kids dividing them into, this is my premium collection, this is the okay collection. This is the collection I can play marbles with. We divide things. And it was no different in past biblical days. They did it as well. You know, you had the Romans and the barbarians. You had the Jews and the Gentiles. You had the slaves and the free people. There were categories. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, starting at verse 18, we're going to take a look at Paul's thought process on dividing. He's dividing a group between the perishing and the saved, the ones that are dying in their sins and the ones that were saved by the beloved Lord Jesus Christ. So we're going to look at it today. 3 points on Paul's division of the perishing and the saved. First, we're going to look at the first point, and that would be the difference, because that's the whole reason we divide things. We divide things to know the differences, to weigh the goods and the bads. So let's take a look at the difference. To get Paul's point here, you must understand human nature. So you see, God created us to gravitate toward Him, making Him first in our lives. That's the whole reason God created us, so that we could be companions and worship Him. And that's why we were created. Unfortunately, sin came in. And when sin came in, it created human nature. And human nature's sinful heart and our rebellion spirit is, we want to be first placed in our lives. And that's where the whole crux of this is, dividing the perishing from the saved. The difference being, who's first in your life? See, that's the two piles that Paul was making here. The ones that are first themselves in their lives, which are the perishing one, because we can't get ourselves to heaven without Jesus Christ. And the ones that put God first in their lives. Now understand this, pay attention and understand this for me. If God's first in your life, that means you have to be sacrificing daily. You have to be dying to self daily, because for anyone to be first in your life other than yourself means that you're following God. Now, there's a lot of people out there that confess to be Christians, but they're not following God's lead. And the one qualifying aspect of the two piles that Paul's talking about here is who's first in your life. If God is not first in your life, and He hasn't been first in your life for a long time, maybe even never, maybe we just played that way. I got news for you. You're not in the saved pile. You're in the perish pile. Because anyone that is saved, that has the Holy Spirit in us, truly wants God as our master and truly will be motivated to die to self, to be in the saved pile. We just talked about that in Sunday school. You cannot have repentance and still live the same life that you were living before. There has to be a noticeable difference. Because if there's not a noticeable difference, then there is no sacrifice. If there is no sacrifice, there is no worship. If there is no worship, you belong in the perishing pile. Because that's the characteristic of being a Christian. A disciple, I'm not even sure I like the word Christian anymore. A disciple for Jesus means that he has to be first in your life, which means you have to sacrifice, which means you have to give up your comfort to follow what God wants you to do. Now, if that's the way your life is right now, then you're in this pile over here. If you don't recognize what I'm talking about, I would be worried that I might be in the other pile. So Paul is going on to talk about this. Our self-centeredness is deep. If you're following human nature, our self-centeredness is deep and brutal. We don't care what we do to other people. We don't care what actions we make, as long as it satisfies us. And I think you all know what I'm talking about. You know some people that make very selfish choices in your life, and they don't care how it affects you. That's not what Jesus did. And if that ain't what Jesus did, that's what as disciples we shouldn't do. There are some relationships that you need to walk away from as believers in Jesus Christ because they are toxic. Because you're rubbing up against sinful nature. And God says that we need to be apart from that. Look at verse 19. Well, first of all, let me read verse 18. For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but it is God's power to those that are being saved. That's how He divides the power, or the piles up. You see, if you don't know Jesus Christ, then everything that I'm telling you about self-sacrifice, everything that I'm telling you about doing things for others, everything I'm telling you about love others as yourself, love thy neighbor, all these things are foolishness to you. Why would I want to do that? Why would I want to give up my comfort, my plan, my way, and sacrifice to do the other? It's foolishness. But Paul's saying for those that are in the saved pile, it's the power of God. Willing to give up, willing to sacrifice, willing to serve God and put Him first in your life, taps into God's power so that you can do it. Over here, you can care less. Now let me read verse 19. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and I will set aside the understanding of the experts. Paul's quoting this from Isaiah 29:14, where he says that he will destroy the wise. That wise is those that rely on human thought, human wisdom, human logic. That's all going to be destroyed. Because you see, no matter who you are, no matter what background you come from, no matter what age you are, one day you will face your God, and you will face His judgment. And when you bring forth what you have, and if it all stems from human wisdom, human logic, self-centeredness, it will be burned up like hay and stubble. Gone. Eviscerated. Because Paul says He will destroy it. God will destroy it. But if you bring to Him your humbleness, your servitude, the things that you did to die to self, the sacrifice which turned into worship on this side, you will be purified as gold. These experts stand and say things. Their ego, their human logic, their faith in self will be destroyed and burn up. God's judgment will expose all pretentiousness of human wisdom that's not anchored in Christ. Do you understand what I just said? Because if not, I will repeat it for you. Whatever you do in life, no matter how smart you are, no matter how intelligent you are, no matter how successful you are, no matter how great and materialistic things that you have, it is hay and stubble that will be destroyed at Judgment Day, and you will see God at Judgment Day. And they'll be worthless to you. Buildings that are named after you is worthless. The joy that you had here is gone. Human wisdom leads us into sin, and without repentance, God will hand you over to that sin. Romans 1:24 says, therefore God delivered them over in the cravings of their heart to sexual impurity, so that their bodies were degraded amongst themselves. If that's truly what you want, God will give you what you want. He will give you over to it because of free will. But understand this, you're the one that made the choice. Talked about it again in Sunday school about the blood is not on my hands. That's what Paul said. I've done everything I had to do. I've preached the word, I preached it pure, and I preached it true. It is now your choice, and I have nothing left to do. You're not in Sunday school. We have some great conversations.
Amen.
So that's my plug for Sunday school. Let me give you our second point. And that second point is the power of God. We've just seen that again in verse 18. In the second half of it says, but it is God's power to us who are being saved. This is a vital point that Paul is trying to make. And he doesn't want them in Corinth to think of the gospel as just another philosophical system. There are people that stand on Corinth, on the corners, spotting out philosophical systems all day long, showing how wise they are. But Paul doesn't want that for the gospel. He wants it plain, he wants it simple, and he wants it foolish to them. Because he wants to make sure it is separated. Just like the piles that we're talking about, the foolish, self-dying pile versus the selfless giving of power, pile of God's people, where the power is. He wants it separated. Because he understood, and I understand, that systems fail humans. You don't believe me? Look at the systems they are about dieting. There are books galore about a system on how to lose weight. Systems fail. Why? Because human nature takes them away. Systems require devotion. Systems require diligence to stay with it. Human nature is not built that way. Human nature wants what's best for us when we want it. You want that piece of cake, then you're going to eat that piece of cake. Anybody tell me that ain't true, just go ahead and speak out now. Yeah, that's what I thought. That's human nature. self first. Systems fail people, but God's word doesn't fail. That's what Paul is dividing here. This is full of foolishness to live upon their own abilities in reality with human nature. That system will always fail because human nature does what human nature wants to do. There's no discipline. There's no commitment. There's no desire to serve anything but self. But God's power that we tap into gives us the ability to deny human nature, to put it away, and to do things for God that normally we wouldn't do. You see, the gospel doesn't rely on human systems or human nature. The gospel relies on the power of God. Human systems rely upon the ability for human nature to sacrifice. And human nature is not going to sacrifice. We are impotent when dealing with our own sins and reconciliation with God. You will never get there from this pile on your own abilities. It is the power of the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ that transfers you to this pile. And then from the Holy Spirit that lives within you is where you tap to God's power to continue to live for Him. Say amen if you believe that.
Amen.
Okay. Just making sure I didn't lose anybody. You see, the gospel is not just simply good advice. It's not the next bestseller on how to live. It's not the good news about God's power. The gospel is God's power. You can live through God's power by living through His Word. And it's the only way that you're going to be able to die to self. It's the only way that gives you the motivation to follow Christ and be like Christ. Amen. To whom those believe, God's Word is God's power. It is the roadmap to life. It is the answer to every question. It is the equipment to build your faith. It is the peace to have a prayer life. Everything that you need is in God's gospel. Relayed through the Holy Spirit that lives within you. Those are the difference between the two divisions that Paul is making here. We've only went through two verses in 1 Corinthians so far. And there's a lot there. Let's go to the third point. And the third point is worldly wisdom. We talked about God's power. Now let's talk about worldly wisdom. Matthew 16:26 says, "What will it benefit a man if he gains the whole world and yet loses his life?" Let's think about that question for just a minute. What does it benefit us if the world laid down and gave us everything that we desired? As much money as we desire, homes, houses, 50,000 kids, I'd be wore out. All that, never a worry or an issue. We'll even throw that in. But what good does all that benefit you when you face your God at judgment day? If you do not have the blood of Jesus Christ cleansing you of your sins, if you do not have a life filled with study and sacrifice serving God, if you do not have a life that is servitude to God Almighty, on judgment day, what good is all that? Because now, your soul will forever be in the lake of fire, hell and brimstone, swelling of tongue, gnashing of teeth. Those 50 cars that you have in that garage, not worth a thing. Those 4 houses that you have, not worth a thing. Have you ever thought about it? Now this is for the younger generation. Lauren and I have passed this prime. If you're raising a child right now, they are watching you. You are their witness on how to live. They're understanding life through the wisdom that you're showing them. Is it humanly wisdom? Is it wisdom of self-indulgence? Or is it a wisdom of self-control? Is it a wisdom of everything always in a panic and your schedule so busy you can't breathe? Or is it a wisdom of God has it? God's got this. Mayhem, peace. What are you teaching your children? And is that really worth it? When I was writing this sermon, I read this verse and I spent the whole morning on meditation on this verse. And I've read this verse a gazillion times, but God just put this so heavily on my heart. The weight of this question is eternal. It is. This question, the weight of this question on how you answer it is eternal. It's the question that divides the two piles that Paul's been talking about. Is serving self really worth what you're going to get in the end? Or is giving your life to Jesus Christ worth the sacrifice now to receive the ending that you're going to get? In those days in Corinth, wisdom was public philosophy, standing on the corner spouting out what they thought would be worldly view. Their thoughts on this subject was those that could make sense of the world, control the world. It gave them followers. It gave them believers. It boosted their ego. Probably even gave them finances. That's why Paul asks in verses 20 and 21, where is the philosopher? Where is the scholar? Where is the debater of this age? Hasn't God made the world's wisdom foolish? For since in God's wisdom, the world did not know God through wisdom, God was pleased to save those who believed through the foolishness of the message preached. Paul introduces God's indictment against those views who view themselves as wise in this age. Those who viewed themselves as having control of the world with what they were saying that was not of the gospel but of human wisdom, Paul is telling them, this is what's going to happen to you. The last question in verse 20. God made the world's wisdom foolish. It showcases the futility of world wisdom. This always drives me crazy. The world always talks about peace. Peace in the Middle East. Peace in the Middle East. Peace talks in the Middle East. Peace, peace, peace. I got news for you, worldly wisdom people. There will never be peace until Jesus comes back. Because too many people are in the perishing pile. Too many people are following human wisdom. Too many people want what they want. They're not willing to sacrifice for God's will. The world believes the gospel is foolishness. But God determined to save people on the basis of their trust in the foolish message preached, Christ crucified. If you're willing to deny human nature and human wisdom and put God first and accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, God is delighted to give you that gift of salvation. Now, usually, Preachers will tell you it's a free gift. I'm here to tell you it'll cost you everything. Accepting Jesus Christ as your personal Savior is going to cost you everything that you know right now, but you're going to realize once you do it, you paid absolutely nothing, because that's filthy rags. But it is commanded by repentance to turn away from those filthy rags. Not to dabble in human nature. Not to dabble in human desires. Not to dabble in pet sins. But to give it at the foot of the cross. Deny it as sacrifice for servitude for Jesus Christ, who is your personal Savior. That's where the muck comes in. That's where the waters get muddy for a lot of people. They want to accept Jesus Christ as a personal Savior. They're willing to accept that Christ crucified, but they want a little bit of this left. That's human nature saying, well, okay, you've got all this, but every now and then come back over here and just enjoy yourself a little bit. You can always ask God to forgive you. That's not the message that Paul was saying. In Acts chapter 20, in Sunday school once again, we found that Paul was charging the disciples at Ephesus to stand firm on God's message, to stand pure and true when you give it out. It is your choice, as Paul says, because my hands are not clean from the blood of your choice. Because I gave you the truth of the gospel. Here's the conclusion. The cross divides the human race. No doubt about it. Saved versus lost. Heaven versus hell. Obedient versus rebellious. The cross divides the human race in between these two piles. You can't escape it. You can't get around it. You're going to have to get through it, and you're going to have to make the choice. Do you serve self or do you serve Jesus Christ? Your choice. Don't think you're going to fool him, because one day you're going to see him. And the question I have for you today is, which side are you on? Are you on the human nature side, the rebellious side, the sinful side, the self-pleasure side, the making choices that serve you side, or you are on the salvation side, the dying to self side, the worshiping side, the love-showing side of life? As Joshua says, I don't know about others, but as for me and my house, which is on the road of my house, we serve the Lord. We have chosen our side, and we have had battles. We have had battle scars. We have had people say false things about us. We have had people treat us miserably. But we give it as glory for the service of Jesus Christ. And if that's what it takes to serve my God, bring it. Because I'm going to leave this world one day. And when I do, I want to make sure I give everything that I have for Jesus Christ. How about you? If we can start by beating that 30 dozen cookie goal. And if you want to bring your broken ones in for inspection, just bring them to me. And we'll just inspect them. Bag your heads with me if you want. If you're here today and you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, I'll even go in a little further. If you're here today and you're not sure you know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior right now, you're just not sure because of what you compared yourself today with God's Word. Now's the time to get that right. All you need to do is say this prayer. You don't have to say it out loud, but you do have to mean it. That's the key. Lord, forgive me of my sins. I'm lost and I need you in my life. Replace my will with yours and I will follow you from eternity. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. With every head still bowed and every eye still closed. If you said that prayer through our video ministry, welcome to the family of God. We invite you to come here to Shining Light Baptist Church, 294 Mount Vernon Avenue, Marion, Ohio, 43302, and tell us about that decision that you made so that we can help start your path as a disciple of Jesus Christ. Maybe you have a home church. Maybe your family has a home church that you're comfortable with. Then I encourage you to go to that pastor and tell them about the choice that you made today so that they can start you on your path as a disciple for Jesus Christ. If you're here today, and you said that prayer because you just wasn't sure, or maybe you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, you're here to get that right. No one's looking around. Just raise your head and look up at me. I'm going to ask you three questions. Maybe you're here today and you're a believer in Jesus Christ. Maybe you haven't been following God. Let me just say this. If you recognize your walk in the perishing pile more than you recognize your walk in the servant pile, the saved pile, then I suggest you get that right through the Holy Spirit, because you and I both know what God's Word says about serving Him. You don't need me to tell you. You have the Holy Spirit telling you right now. You can make that right today. This altar is open for you as well. Maybe it's repentance. Maybe it's joining the local fellowship. Whatever God has in your heart. To my left, your right, we have prayer warriors and counselors standing by to help you during the invitation down here at the kingdom business. At my right, your left, is where you can get things right with your Father all by yourself. Where you can go to Him and ask for forgiveness and the next step in guidance of where He wants you to be. Now listen to me. Maybe you're here and you don't want to come down front. If you just slip up your hand, we have prayer warriors throughout the congregation that will come over and pray with you. Our job here at Shining Light Baptist Church is to make your walk stronger when you leave this church than it was when you came in. And we do that through the music, worship, God's Word, and the offering of free prayer and counseling. God loves you, and so do we. All right, let me look up. Go to me, please.
Won't you stand with me, please?